you very much everybody for coming out this evening. It's great to see so many people. Before I make a start, I would like to invite up Grania to say a few words before we show a short video. Monday, Friday, we'll start coming.
I'm Grania Mike. I've just written this shit Fishan or Malav the Mayor for it, giving you my Aher Harry of the Species Gary Hashbunch and John Octopus. Dear Fergler, a couple of Fockle or off we. Okay. So this is a short video just in memory of my father Harry, but this year his fruit shop closed after 20 years I think it was open. August Snurfer Shape Was just go made in Chapla Jirach Cookie Shinnation. So my sister May decided to take on the farming business 2 weeks after my daddy was murdered, which the whole family thought was very brave of where it was, and she kept the shop going now for 10 years and trying to compete with supermarkets and high prices and everything else, and wasn't making any money in her shop, but she wanted to keep the shop going, and she did a really good job. So this was just a wee video kind of telling me a story and also giving me my Aher Fáilte and Tamin tap week or a lech and not to give me my auntie and cheese in, or as they meet in Dakabi and she, or as Tomajaleki and tap broda last year, or as Tamin Lashi tap broda, Babel Darag or my auntie, a B and she, or as Innsbruck over a B and she sales sugging or fad. So this Tamin lecture tonight is also dedicated to my auntie Teresa. I just want to say thanks very much. Growing up on us, our Teresa was a massive inspiration in all our lives. We all looked up to her all our life, and you know, all the work, everything she achieved for this community, and how positive she was. But not only that, she was a laugh, like anyone who knew her could just say that she was just so funny. So she loved kids, and she was a big child herself, and despite how intelligent she was, I think she preferred the company of kids. And so big, us being big kids ourselves, we all just had the crack at her every time we see her, and you know, that's what everybody's going to miss the most. So behind all that work and everything she did do for our community, she just really was such a wonderful, bright and positive person. If I could be half as positive as her, I'll be the main taxaster. So Garvita Myogriff, Laura Mona, as Shelly Anna doing this.
Naran Dini Bas, Tashid Gaforlin Shaw, Valak Marbian, Kevnig Dini Alar, who August Marn Shid Freed in a Kevnishin. Shin Mortashi Lama Ahar, V. Aigna Igahan Dinur, Tiskeli Gahan Dinufui. Hanik Dini Ishahidin Chapel, Rodigan Achianak, Douglas Jimmy Shid Hartfa, Urachleganiation. Hanik Dini Ishakion Eshin Aakal, Hanama Kahulish. Vikyol Guni Gulsa Shapa. Jay Sheila, Leonard Cohen, Bob Dylan, Green Day, Damien Dempsey, Gaxor Kjol, agus Beodini, Jack Dishjack, Lelorch, Leish Fuin Kjol. Bishi and Takol, agur Kursi Politiakta, Nia Wine, and Aaron, agur Fudden Doan, agus Beodini, Jack Dishjack, Lelorch, Leish Fuin Arolishin. Duskal Shane Shoppa, Hard for me, Jake Nohokui, Gogus, Fime Hienax, Miera Furry, Goberon, Lakela, La Blinta, V Cracker Doy, Ogino Naguni. Is Kevin Lumveen, which Aguni and Tak Greyhack, Eganulog? V Hard for Kui Grogin, Suspas, Buggy, Kulan Shapa, Igarin, Naprati. V much Shucky Fur, Gus Igarin. Ak V Cracker Doy on Leshin Kyol, Igul, Ogus Miari against Skelty, Ogus Igul, Oren. Vishay Guni Kyol, Vishay Guni Chak, Morology A Kani. Vishay Guni Cafe, Ogus Rule Up, Guni and Alawiga. Galaxy Tree Sugra, Ogus Beoshe, Kern, Spunog Heart, Ogus Hearts of Kopani Kainchlet. Ogus Hil Hagro, Iv Sakopanigan, Doya Wilshe and Kopanlishan Spunog. Rinche Iv Dohi and Sakitchel, Vishin Gromwer, Ogus Aaron Rosser and Pekin Machine. Cosi Shation and No Sugus Remodulation. Vijay Cossel a Club Bugginshaw, Dini Chak, Douglas Gimak, Atmosphere and Takon. Boily Madari Carti, Picturey, Ogus Ruddy Exil, Ogus Crocshe and Waliad. Bagrala Dini Ruddy a Horcheray, Shona Codgley and Desirado. Dunwaru Mayari a Ga Vilis a Shacht, Cookie Shinnyedo Boisail, Duskel Main Chopper Ish Mehien. Vime Cree Brishja. Ak Hanikum Pubble Akiel August Kodji Shied Lumsa August Leshen Chowlach. Dusa, Leshen Chopper Oskulcha. Vise Bioga Foil. August V. Frigness Gaelti August Nakivni a Vig Diniella. Kodji Shiego Morlum available de Dele Leshen Chailowinch. August and Doy Dragajach of Furche Bois. Kerme Eichna, Ernard Chindini und Kianter. Dini to Uignach, August Vien Shopper, Markoj de Routine Saki. Hanik Shied Higgin Shopper, or Waihala Choluder, August Crack. Chamber Kur, Chick Kodge White in a Dini Shaw, on Tori August Glassaria, or Chucky. Earn Shidderam Hakdish Jack, August Bean Crackogin, August Cup on Tay. Tapubble or Lay Huggin at Shaw, Mel Firstja, Dini a Hanik Freach, Drakham, Milchenach. Tiskiel Tragadach, Ig Ahan Darna Denyas, a Kyantor Shaw. Heg Shid Kajam Marvi Rully Dusa, August Kodji Shid Gomorlum. Anish Tashe Markojda Routine Sogam Hien. Ig Lord Slishna Dini Un Pubal, Ig Eishak Lishan Crack, Ogus Gakrodataig Tarlu. Kehim Wajun Shapa Regimenish. Tashe Ra Yakar Ave Gomertus Lina Shapi Mora. Khani Me Gole Le Jape Mlena La Anyam Hari Us Kunan Doris. Shinan Rodis Tawak Di Dusa. Tagan Jury le Gakrod ak Tussian Ray Nua. Chaim Higna Hechna avi duoli carion ogus mahim guel shen shin urvalach. Tamian tak buik gareshan miade. Te kera pwais jogamanish. August tashid leig kusulish ur doyana de frula. Nurak and dini mawak, August minyin, jirin shid lum gwil shi jira kusulish. August ta. Ke gomien bruna de kri, bien ahasa de kri fosta fwin ke glionella. Niveo shid sunun gan mayade. August marin che yontu. Janam kivnir an aradi arin che lin. August Jana Mirak Narali Kierna Ayanu Lim of Weiss Jihin. Tana Kivnishin Ian Tak Tawatak Du. August Bawailum Nikivnishin A Horchdom of Weiss Jihin. Gak Rada Yanam and Mihil Smunium Kijaya Yan Hidhari. Tasuologum Kavak and Dini Amwaihisavion. Oni.
John.
Frish.
Lay. Thank you for bringing me that was quite touching and insightful video. Thank you so much, Randy and your family, for sharing that with us here tonight. Can we just give another round of applause, please? And again, as I said, thank you everybody for coming along, and thank you to Fergal for asking me to join this event. I'm both honoured and privileged. As Brona has said, my name is Marisa McMahon. I work for the Participation and Practice of Rights, which is a human rights organisation who works to support various campaigns organising at a grassroots level using a human rights based approach. Some of these campaigns include Right to Work, Right to Welfare, issues around homelessness and housing inequality, the right to mental health provision, travellers' rights, the right to play, the right to education, as well as looking at the Institute of Second Seekers and Refugees. Throughout all these campaigns, the same approach is used. We find the people, we identify their issues, we wrap these issues in rights, and we hold those responsible to account. I currently work on a joint project between PPR and the Selma community the largest homeless charity in the north, looking at issues of homelessness. But I have been involved with PPR for over 10 years now. Yeah, way too long, I think, now that I'm standing here thinking about it. PPR was founded in 2006 by an absolutely formidable activist, Enis McCormick, who, amongst many things, was a social worker. And I want to say right here in this very area, but in people's very territorial. So this is not Ballymurphy, she was a social worker in Ballymurphy, quite close. She went on to become the first female president of the Irish Congress of Trade Unions. She advocated strongly for human rights provisions in the Good Friday Agreement, and she was a signatory on the McBride Principles. However, undoubtedly her sense of activism and her need to address the growing inequality here in the North was born out of her partaking on one of the first marches from Belfast to Derry in the Civil Rights Movement 50 years ago this year. Again, as Brona says, more recently I, along with Sean Brady, as many of you know, completed a Social Change Initiative Fellowship, which seen me and Sean travel to New York, New Jersey, Boston, South Africa, Cape Town, Johannesburg, Durban, Pretoria, to further explore the extent of inequalities and human rights abuses, and work with activists and campaigners and people on the ground just trying to affect day-to-day change like many of us here do back home. I firsthand seen people in Khayelitsha successfully campaigning for their basic human right of sanitation, such things we take for granted. I got to be a part of an occupation in inner city Cape Town, and that's why I was glad to see our comrades down south taking buildings and still going strong. It was funny. 2 years ago when the occupation started, it was meant to be symbolic in Cape Town. They've held the ANC government to account for all the things that they have not yet done, and it's still going strong. I also see children, the next generation, agents of social change, campaigning to have, again, simple things that we take for granted here, safe structural buildings for them to go to school in. I met with mothers who sent their kids out to school and they didn't come home because they fell down pit toilets and died in their own feces, who had walls caved in on them. So all these small victories, which were big for their people. Out of this junket, was that what you called it, Fergal? Out of this junket that me and Sean Brady was on, we relaunched a website in this very building not 2 months ago, lessonsforchange.org, as part of the FELA, and it was amazing to have a panel of our comrades, especially from South Africa, Tupelo and the Czech Brothers Movement in Durban. I think equally as important is the network of global activists that Social Change Initiative has allowed us to convene with and learn from. This time last year, I was sat with Bernadette McCallisky, who needs no other introduction, along with Desmond Tutu, discussing what was left off every peace agreement in the world, probably, and it was what we had came to was the social and economic rights of people. I was learning from and working with one of the co-founders of Black Lives Matter, Opal Tometi, on what's being denied to her people back home, and much closer to home, I was working with and still continue to work with closely, Craig Dwyer and Denise Charton, two of the people who headed up and successfully campaigned in Yes Equality and Reveal 8th. A lot more that I've wrote down, but if I talk all night, Matt Collins is going to kill me. So, all of whom, regardless, are continuing to fight for their basic civil rights in this day and age owed to their people. So before I hand over to Matt and Paul, I had no part in what I'm about to say next. This is their own two bios that I've just been asked to read out loud. Matt Collins recently completed a PhD from Queen's University, looking at the history of the people's democracy here in the North. He is an elected councillor with the Socialist Party, People Before Profit, in Belfast City Council. And Paul McGann is a singer-songwriter from Armagh, and by his own admission, and Brona's here, she can witness this, is a drunkard hillbilly. Yeah, who will be singing for this evening. I've been told I no longer have to do anything else. Sorry, that's me done. Thank you. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Marisa. And first of all, just to thank the organisers and Fergal and everyone else for the invitation along here to speak. Like Marisa, it was an honour to be asked. I've been coming to this lecture when I can throughout the last number of years, and I hope to do it some justice. There's been very good talks previously. And I think it's fitting when you consider the community aspect of this centre and indeed the community aspect of the people that make up this room and this event that we talk about the anniversary of 1968 here in Ireland. Of course, 1968 in Ireland was a seminal year, but it was in Ireland, but it was also a seminal year globally. It was one defined really by the emergence of popular social struggles for progressive change on an international scale, from the Black Civil Rights Movement in the US to the mass movement against the Vietnam War and the student and worker mobilisations that engulfed large parts of Europe, right through really the events in October 68 in Prague, when the kind of veneer, I suppose, of actually existing socialism began to crack as workers and students in the Czech Republic rose up to demand democracy and liberation. So 1968 should be seen really as a generational rupture, a period of great possibility, I think, a period when it began to imagine a world beyond the limitations of both free market liberal capitalism and the sort of one-party states of the Eastern Bloc. It was a time when globally, I think the pendulum seemed to swing in the direction of progress, a time to demand the impossible, as Che Guevara once urged. And in an Irish context, I think demanding the impossible meant the struggle to overcome a state which had practiced discrimination and sectarianism for a five decade long history, to overcome the power of a government that was deeply repressive by nature. And the civil rights movement really erupted onto the streets in Belfast and Derry five decades ago this week. It represented the Irish expression of the global revolt. I think that obviously it is the case that the violence and the repression that then met the civil rights movement was transformative in the sense that it led, I suppose, the conditions for a protracted period of conflict. And because of this, I think interpretations of the civil rights period speak directly to the causes of conflict here in the North. And because of this precisely, I think what we're seeing is a systematic attack really on the history and tradition of the civil rights movement. And really in an effort to denigrate the role of the radical left and groups like the People's Democracy. I'll give you one example. Take Nelson McCausland, and I promise not to talk too long about Nelson McCausland, but Nelson McCausland recently intervened in the Belfast Telegraph with an article to warn of the apparently groundbreaking fact that Republicans and Communists were involved in setting up and getting involved in leading the civil rights movement. And what was really a lazy effort on McCausland's part to repeat the old kind of myth that the civil rights movement represented a Republican plot to undermine the Northern state. Now, this myth, of course, was really the official lane of the Unionist establishment in the late 1960s. It was strongly proclaimed by pro-Unionist party media outlets. It served as a rallying cry from Ian Paisley and his crowd, who went on to systematically abuse civil rights activists throughout 1968 and 69. Now, this myth is easily refuted by the most basic historical study is clearly lost upon the Nelson McCausland of this world, and we probably wouldn't expect any other ways. But what I want to argue today is that this kind of debate here from people like McCausland, it really continues to get a sound here because the attack upon the civil rights movement is so deeply ingrained, particularly within academic historiography. I think it's often categorised by a downplaying of the role of the state in terms of repressing the civil rights movement, and also a focus upon civil rights activists themselves and a critique of them for so-called provoking sectarianism and violence. And really among an academic community that was strongly shaped by the conflict that raged in the aftermath of the civil rights movement, there's been much effort to attach culpability towards those who are seen to have provoked and caused sectarian violence. And I think the radical left in this sense have become an easy target. And I think in the first instance, it's worth saying that this, in a most basic sense, relies upon a process of victim blaming, whereby civil rights activists who had significant levels of violence inflicted upon them are held responsible for the violence of the state. But it also involves more specific arguments that the Unionist state could reform in this period, and the civil rights movement prevented this. So I want to focus in on the PD and the Bertollet March in particular, and the attempt to challenge this. But before, I want to speak specifically about the Cameron Report and the type of interpretation that the British government put out at this time. And in challenging that, I hope to kind of explore some of the ways in which I think the civil rights movement represented a break from past traditions here in the North, but it was ultimately violently repressed, both by the British state and the Unionist state. Now, I'm not going to say a whole lot about the background to the civil, the roots of the civil rights struggle, only to say that obviously it is the case that the Northern state that was formed after partition was a draconian state that practiced one-party rule, where elections were a done deal for a 10-year period. And moreover, it was a deeply repressive state, as anyone with any understanding of partition knows. It was a state that relied upon quasi-paramilitary police force. It was a state that had discrimination enshrined into it in areas, three key areas, of jobs, housing, and the electoral franchise. But on the surface, while the Orange State purported as kind of an image of stability and ultimately triumphalism for Unionist bosses, being as it was strongly supported by the largest imperialist empire in the world, under the surface it was a state built upon deep contradictions. The Unionist state, when it was first originally designed, was represented some of the biggest industries in the British Empire. Ultimately, these industries were in terminal decline since partition. If you look at the economic history of the Orange State, the only time that there was a real economic boom was during the Second World War, and it was fueled by the war economy in terms of industry and arms and all the rest of it. So by the late 1950s, the linen industry, the textile industry, the shipbuilding industry, this was a state in decline. Orange capital was in decline, and this economic reality precipitated a form of ostensibly liberal Asian unionism and the administration of Terence O'Neill, at a time when aesthetic moves such as visiting Catholic schools were seen as radical, which says something about the extent to which the state was entirely backward. So by the late 1960s, the original economic basis of partition was eroded, and I think this, combined with changes in the aftermath of the Second World War, the introduction of the welfare state, the expansion of the education system, which really led to a growing Catholic middle class, it led to a more confident Catholic middle class, it led to an expansion of white-collar Catholic workers, such as teachers and all the rest of it. This led to a contradiction within the heart of the state. You had a growing, confident Catholic minority, which sensed an opportunity for advancement, and on the other hand, you had sections of unionism that perceived regression because of their state, the history of that state of preferential treatment was under siege, or perceived to be so. And that real contradiction is right to the heart of the civil rights movement. I think it continued to defend the period after, and I think it continued to defend the period today. And I think those changes, they're quite unique to the North, they were something that happened on a global level, and I think Paul's going to sing a couple of songs now that they can encapsulate the global aspect of the civil rights movement, so thank you.
Okay. I'm going to start off with a wee song here written by Dylan. I don't share his politics, because I know he has Zionist tendencies and all that, but he can write a bloody good song, and he can write a bloody good poem. And this song is a song that I don't normally sing. I haven't sang it, in fact, I don't think. But I'm going to give it a bite tonight because I think it's fairly fitting. It's a song that would have been popular along with the during the days of the struggle for civil rights in the States, and of course the anti-war movement over there. It's a song called The Times That Are Changing.
Come gather round, people, wherever you roam, and admit that the waters around you have grown, and accept that soon you'll be drenched to the bone. If your time to you is worth saving, then you better start swimming, it'll sink like a stone. For the times, they are changing. Come writers and critics to prophesy with your pen. Keep your eyes wide, the chance won't come again. And don't speak too soon, for the wheel's still in spin. There's no telling who that it's naming. For the loser now will be later to win. And the times, they are a-changing. Come senators, congressmen, please heed the call. That gets hurt will be he best off. half understand. Your sons and your daughters are beyond your command. Your old road is rapidly aging.
Campaign for Civil Rights, which began really with the campaign for social justice, I suppose, in 1964, and then really in earnest with NICRA, the Northern Ireland Civil Rights Association, in 1967. It had hitherto been conducted through, I suppose, acceptable and respectable means, but the kind of cautious approach which defined that period, I think, was soon superseded when small signs of public protest began to get a much wider resonance. People will know, the stories of Austin Curry and occupying houses, and people putting caravans out on the road in Derry in order to protest housing problems. So the roots of a more radical revolt, I think, emerged out of that kind of explosive fusion between changing local conditions and the immense influence that the global struggles of the 1960s had in the north. If you look at the first 18 months of NICRA's activity, for example, it was basically a lobbying group that wrote strongly worded letters to the government and all the rest of it, and they didn't go very far, as you can imagine. But by the summer of 68, this lobbying strategy was exhausted. And as they say, small-scale local agitation paved the way, really, for the suggestion of the first civil rights march, the first NICRA march, from Coleland to Dungannon on the 24th of August. It mobilised over 2,000 people. The march was significant. By the end of the march, people were singing "We Shall Overcome." It was the international anthem for civil rights in that period. And events in Dungannon really gave a group of radical activists in Derry the excuse, I suppose, to call a march in our city. And the march in Derry was significantly different in the sense that it was to pass through the main so-called unionist area of the city, which was banned by the Minister of Home Affairs at the time, William Craig. Now, after haphazard negotiations with NICRA, the Derry Radicals got their support, and a busload of young socialist activists from Belfast joined the demonstration. The young socialists, it's worth saying, were modelled on their name with the same counterpart from the US, and they'd spent the year at Queen's organising solidarity actions around anti-Vietnam War activity, the Russian invasion of Czechoslovakia, and all the rest of it. And the students arrived at Derry, actually, if you look at the, and there are some of these floating about to this day, if you look at their original placards that the student activists took up, on the one hand they had demands about the civil rights movement here, on the other they had slogans about the Prague Spring. So that kind of encapsulates the international dimension to it. Now the students arrived to Derry concurrent to a tense standoff between the RUC and the organisers of the march at Duke Street, when the civil rights activists held a public meeting where some of the moderate leaders were purportedly to ask people to go home, and Michael Farrell, one of the leaders of the Young Socialists, describes what happened next. He says, "We were not having that. It was 1968, the year of student revolutions in Prague and Paris, of Mexico City and the Chicago Democratic Convention. We didn't quite think of ourselves in that league, but going home peacefully meant letting Bill Clegg and the RUC walk all over us." Of course, Farrell goes on to say that he doesn't quite remember what happened next, as the RUC baton hit him in the head. The RUC baton charged the crowd, which included, at the time, three British Labour Party MPs, in a frenzied attack really to break up the march. And the events of October 5th were really the turning point, as the bloody scenes were broadcast all across the world. And that was the moment really when the first significant riot began across the city in Derry, and a mass movement was emerging. Now, if I want to focus, for the purpose of this talk, and focusing on the PD, it's worth saying that the presence of Queen's students on the dairy demonstration weren't in any way an aberration in European terms. Across Europe in the 1960s, student radicalism emerged in an explosive way that was rooted really in the changes to the university system in this period, namely the expansion of university and third level education at this time to suit the needs of the system and the growing needs of capitalism, the expansion of people from working class backgrounds in the university life. Now in Belfast, of course, this had the added impact not only of introducing more working class people into the university system, but also those from a Catholic background. Queen's University had once primarily been the preserve of Protestant elites, Protestant male elites perhaps, but by the late 1960s, Queen's University was opened up to a hopeful generation of Catholics who later ensured really that their demands for equality would gain traction. And significantly, I think these same developments also produced a layer of Protestants who for a brief period at least identified more strongly with the sort of global student rebellion and the cause for civil rights than they did with the conservative trappings of the Unionist state. So it was in this context that the Belfast students returned to their campus angry and outraged and full of indignation in order to organise solidarity actions with what had happened in Derry. And so it was that on the 9th of October, 2,000 students took to the streets to protest what had happened in Derry and raise the civil rights demands. If you look at the arcade, the photo at the bottom right there, that's a good photo that sums up the day. Now, the students were blocked by the RUC at Lennon Hall Street. The famous pictures of the sit-down protest took place there. And in the aftermath of this demonstration, really it's here that the people's democracy was formed. The PD, I think, was probably the best expression of the kind of global element of the civil rights movement here in the North. It reflected in many ways in its early period the kind of autonomous student movements that were emerging across Europe at this time. Instead of a formal leadership, they wouldn't have a formal leadership, they would have a 10-person faceless committee that would make decisions. All decisions would be based upon mass meetings and overturned in mass meetings, and they kind of rejected what they seen as the bureaucratic trappings of organisation. In its early formation, the PD was really influenced by Daniel Cohen Bennett, the leader of the French student movement called the Spontaneity of Resistance. The new student revolts of the 1960s, they rose rapidly, they moved fast, they often counterposed the militant vanguards with what was seen as the old left models of patiently building a party and a structure. Of course, this would prove problematic later down the line when key questions of organisation and strategy faced the civil rights movement. But nevertheless, in the weeks that followed October 9th in Belfast, student demonstrations kicked off on a very significant level. There were a number of demonstrations. Once the PD made it into the city centre, I think that was about the last time that a progressive march made it into the city centre for about the next 30 or 40 years. And they joined the much wider civil rights struggle that was emerging across this time. By November, thousands upon thousands of people were marching in Derry, and I think Paul's got another song that can encapsulate that.
I'll give you a wee song written by one of my favourite songwriters, a man by the name of Pete Seeger, who's all familiar with, passed away now. Never sang this song before. Might have sang one for the demonstration years ago. Yeah, but not the whole version. You want to sing it with me, by the way, sing it with me. Alright? Wee song called We Shall Overcome.
We shall overcome. We shall overcome. We shall overcome someday. Oh, deep in my heart, I do believe that we shall overcome someday. We'll walk hand in hand, we'll walk hand in hand, we'll walk hand in hand someday. Oh, deep in my heart, I do believe that we shall overcome someday. We shall live. I do believe that we shall overcome someday. We are not afraid. We are not afraid. We are not afraid today. That we shall overcome someday. The whole wide world around, the whole wide world around, the whole wide world around, someday. Oh, deep in my heart, that we shall overcome one day.
I think the early people's democracy that I've talked about, and indeed the early civil rights movement more generally throughout October and November 1968, it's often seen as a modest contribution to a movement that had real aims, real grievances, and nobody can really anymore deny that discrimination and repression existed under the Orange State. But it was in the changed situation after the announcement of reforms by Clarence O'Neill in late 1968, when the PD pushed ahead with a march from Belfast to Derry, a march that Marisa alluded to, that Inez McCormick was on, and indeed Vinnie McCormick produced the best account of that march, Burnt Pullet, 1969. It's this march which has received criticism. And just in terms, before getting into Burnt Pullet, the background to it, in a space of a few weeks, Clarence O'Neill, the Unionist Prime Minister of Transition, had really become untenable. He was caught between an intensified street movement demanding civil rights and a loyalist backlash that sought to thwart it. And inaction was really no longer an option in terms of the crisis of the state. On the 22nd of November, the Unionist government announced a 5-point programme for reform, which included a point system for housing allocation, a complaints ombudsman to be modelled on the British system, a development commission to implement what was called an area plan for Derry, and the abolition of the company vote under the old electoral system. Business owners could have extra franchise. So in a matter of weeks, it's worth saying that the civil rights movement had secured a better political advancement for the minority community than decades of political stalemate. But although it was a significant claim down by O'Neill, the package fell far short of the programme for reform envisaged by the civil rights movement. In particular, the fundamental grievance of one man, one vote wouldn't be addressed, as the gerrymandered electoral boundaries that existed still remained intact, and furthermore, the notorious Special Powers Act was to remain for all intents and purposes. So O'Neill's reforms essentially had the impact of enraging the loyalist right, which reacted bitterly against any move to reform or concession, while failing to satisfy the civil rights movement at all, whom all the major currents, NICRA, the Derry Citizens Action Committee, the PD, they all denounced the reform package as insufficient. And after the reform package was announced, immediately after, loyalist opposition was intensified. And I think this is very important, because there's often a view that Clarence O'Neill mediated between unionist state, mediated between, on the one hand, the civil rights movement and the loyalist far right and the loyalist hard right. But actually, from reform day one, as soon as they were talked about, the state forces were in the middle of attacking civil rights demonstrators. And in a small, for example, my research is only on the people's democracy. I stumbled across a demonstration on the 23rd of November in Dungannon, 3 days after the reforms package were announced, where essentially a small group of students go into Dungannon to try and raise the civil rights demands. They're immediately put out the restaurant that they're organising the meeting in is attacked. The pregnant owner of the restaurant's beaten up, and the person leading the attack is an off-duty member of the Beat Specials, who my hunch is was the same off-duty member of the Beat Specials who the home was given to, the parliamentary assistant to the home was given to, of which the original Austin Curry protest happened. He was also a unionist councillor, as it happened to be. So that kind of sums up the situation immediately after the reforms package were announced. The following week after that Dungannon demonstration, in the face of a major NICRA rally in Armagh, Paisley Aids virtually took over the town with no opposition from the RUC. They were armed, they shut the whole town down. So in articulating really a traditional unionist response to the civil rights movement, Milton Loyalists have begun to win the support of members of the police force. And this was the type of scenario which continually faced civil rights activists, and I think led the period for a protracted period of civil unrest later in the 1960s. Hardline opposition to the civil rights demands strengthened, and O'Neill took to the airwaves on the 9th of December to appeal to civil rights activists to call off marches, arguing for a cessation of activity and a time frame to implement the November reforms. It's worth saying, of course, that O'Neill's call for calm, it had a resonance. It matched the mood of many of the moderates in the civil rights movement, many of whom had been actually against marching from very early on. It matched the mood of the Nationalist Party and people like that. And in light of that, NICRA and the Derry Citizens Action Committee agreed to a suspension of civil rights mobilisation. In early December, the People's Democracy had met at Queen's, and after a long and from my reading of it, a very contentious meeting, had agreed to call off a demonstration, a planned long march that had been planned for the 21st of December. Now, I think for the socialist left in the PD, the call to cease mobilisation was in essence a capitulation to the Unionist Party, who hadn't given any commitment to fundamental reform. And in effect, the civil rights movement was now being asked to help stabilise the Unionist state by putting her faith in O'Neill. It was in this context that Michael Farrell and other members of the Young Socialists called another PD meeting on campus on the 20th of December, which agreed for a march immediately in the new year. The whole affair, of course, reflected the very nature of the PD, where there were open meetings and anyone, no fixed programme, anyone could go along and decide what was going to happen next. Now, the decision to march on the 1st of January has been the focus of much attention by historians, and it's often presented by historians as one that essentially had the support of a tiny minority of students who were warned against marching by the great magood of the civil rights movement and who went on to provoke violence. For example, Henry Patterson has stated that the march was criticised by the mainstream leaders of the civil rights movement and with the support of only a few dozen students. This is a frequent misrepresentation of the march. The only public caution came from Eddie McAteer, who was the leader of the Nationalist Party at the time, who had disagreed with the civil rights movement from day one, hadn't taken part in the civil rights movement really from day one. Certainly there was private disagreement within NICRA and other civil rights bodies of those who were wary of marching. People like Betty Sinclair and John Hume were undoubtedly among those people. But there was also much support at the time. There was significant support. NICRA and the Derry Citizens Action Committee had agreed and committed to a months-long truce until the 11th of January, so they couldn't physically join the march, but they did support the students in other ways. Financially, NICRA contributed to fund supplies for the march, and its General Secretary, John McInerney, publicly supported this PD, stating, "We are wholeheartedly behind the PD in this. Terence O'Neill has not delivered the reforms." So the Derry Citizens Action Committee, also under the Thames, firmly under the leadership of John Hume, announced that it would meet the marchers when they arrived in Derry, and also a whole slew of other groups. The Dungannon Civil Rights Group urged support. The Falls Division of the Labour Party backed the march, as the Derry Labour Party. The NILP chairman at the time, Paddy Devlin, later an MP, supported the march, funded the march, and helped it in whatever way he can. Thus, although a small crowd of students left Belfast, they could claim much wider support. And beyond that, on the eve of the march, the PD released a statement, and I think it conveys a message about the march which is as relevant to contemporary interpretations of the march as to whom it was originally addressed. It's open in an to read. To those of you who talk of provocation, we can only say that a non-sectarian protest against injustice can offend only those who uphold injustices. It is perhaps as well to repeat that we are commanding not rights, not privileges, but rights, sorry, and that in marching to Derry, we are merely exercising another fundamental democratic liberty. The march, of course, was modelled on the Selma to Montgomery march led by Martin Luther King in Alabama in 1965, and once again a pivotal moment in the US civil rights struggle that inspired what would become perhaps the most eventful march of the Northern Ireland civil rights struggle, certainly in its early period. And I think there's a song which kind of suits the before we begin to talk about what happened on Portullo.
I've got a couple actually. Let me see. I think what I'll do is I'll go for No Time for Love.
Oh, No Time for
Love. Go for the Freedom Walks, yes. Freedom Walks up in your scene. This was one of the first protest songs I ever heard. It was on the B-side of a Barney Horn record. 1975. Okay. In the Modesty Ardwin, and I found the record there, sweet piece of wood, back sweet wood, back with a Mickey Mouse speaker in it, and there was an orange record on one side, was The Men Behind the Wire, the first protest song I'd ever heard. I'll be singing that today, by the way. And the second one was this one, Freedom Walk, and I played it over and over and over and over and over again. I love you.
Cold and dark in the morning, just before the sun, a new day is breaking. Our struggle has begun. People are together. We shall be free in this land, our homeland, our own democracy. So come all you lads and lassies, run into our cause and seek the abolition of those old-fashioned laws. Tell me something, let us open every eye. Let the people see what this land, our homeland, means to you and me. On the road together, walk hand in hand and ring the bells of justice over all the land. The whole world is waiting, watching you and me in this land, our own land, our own democracy.
Sing it with me.
Oh, come on, you lads and lassies, running to our cause and see the abolition of those old-fashioned laws. Let us open every eye, let the people see what this land, our homeland, means to you and me. How far must we travel till our journey is done? How long must we struggle till the fight is won? May we live in peace again. May we live to see this land of our homeland, a true democracy. Rally to our cause and seek the abolition of the old-fashioned laws. Let us open every eye, let the people see what this land, our homeland, means to you and me.
actually printed this off and it actually says there will be something every eye. Who ever came up with that one? What the word drinking at the time, but I think it turned out.
And the events that confronted Celerate's demonstrators from the 1st of January to the 4th of January in 1969 have been well documented. I'm not going to go through it all in great detail, only to say that PD marchers faced obstruction, intimidation, harassment, and severe violence throughout the course of the next 4 days, which exposed really the deep backlash that was developing against the Civil Rights Movement. The major source of violence came from supporters of Ian Paisley and his then right-hand man, Ronald Bunting, who declared their and made true their intent to harry and harass the marchers along their way. The march faced a number of blockades from loyalist armed with weaponry, with cudgels, most notably in Antrim Town, Randallstown, Mahara. However, the violence really reached a crescendo at Birdullet Bridge outside Derry, where a large crowd of loyalists, made up of scores of off-duty beat specials, descended onto the march and violently beat the demonstrators. And when the march regathered and after running the gauntlet of violence at Birdullet Bridge, it was again attacked on the outskirts of Derry, including petrol bombs, bricks, bottles, and another very severe attack of loyalists armed with cudgels and bats. So the PD march began in Belfast with only 40 students. The police report at the time lists about 36 people. By the time it had reached Derry, hundreds had swelled its ranks and thousands had gathered to meet the students at Guildhall at a mass rally. That evening, of course, the beat specials brutally entered the Bogside and attacked residents in what was a clear act of reprisal to the celebration in the city that day. And of course, I mean, that evening, Free Derry was born. The graffiti was put on the wall: "You're now entering Free Derry," in the aftermath of a mass riot when the RUC were pushed back. Of course, the slogan "You're now entering Free Derry" was inspired again by the US Civil Rights Movement that was taken from what was scrawled on the walls of Berklee College, here at Free Berklee, the Free Berklee Speech Movement, I think in 1965. Now, in the immediate aftermath of Birdullet, a severe backlash developed against the PD and against the radical left, which really ignored the way in which state forces were involved in the attack and instead blamed the students for provoking and bringing about violence. Terence O'Neill, people will be familiar with, a famous one-sided statement where he denounced the arrogance of foolhardy students who should go back to their books and all the rest of it. But some months later, the Cameron Report was commissioned. It was the British government's official investigation into events, written by a Scottish judge, Lord Cameron. And really, it laid down the now conventional interpretation of the march, explicitly stating that elements of the PD sought violence and their object was the increased tension. Now, the findings of the Cameron Report, I want to say, are very significant. People may not have read it, but they're very significant in the way that they've shaped the acceptable terms of academic and historical interpretation of the Civil Rights Movement. The report presents the Civil Rights Movement essentially as a movement for genuine reform that was wrecked by a cabal of radical militants who set out to provoke violence in pursuit of an unrealistic radical agenda. Particular fire in its direction at the PD and the Derry left, and by contrast, the report essentially exonerates the RUC as an institution. And I think it's highly problematic, first of all, that this perspective has been accepted so uncritically within academia and throughout historiography, particularly in regards to Birdullet, since any feasible reconstruction of events around the march shows that not only did the PD marchers go to great lengths to maintain non-violence and press for the reform package that was led out by the Civil Rights Movement, not an unrealistic ideal kind of pipe dream by any stretch. But further, an examination of the evidence, and my examination of the evidence, indicates that the RUC did indeed lead the Civil Rights activists into the ambush, which at the very least was acquiesced in by important figures from the Unionist state. This was always, of course, the claim by Civil Rights activists after the attack. If Inez McCormick were still here, she wouldn't need me to tell her it. But historians haven't investigated such claims with any rigour. The Cameron Report objected to them, and I quote, said that they were wholly unjustified, baseless, and indeed ridiculous. Remember that? Wholly unjustified, baseless, and indeed ridiculous. Because the irony is that testimony from the inquiry itself, and indeed police reports from the period, paint a very different picture from the report's conclusions. After the attack, the RUC officers who were charged with policing the march themselves went out of their way to misrepresent what had happened in Burnpullet. The official police report from the ambush was penned by District Inspector Harrison on 6th of January. Of course, that was a few days after the attack, when news of the attack had exploded throughout the media. And Harrison explained that no arrests were made and justified it by saying, and I quote, "The police were fully engaged with getting the marchers through and crushing the attack." He also claimed that the loyalists were attacked and baton charged by the police. Now, the credibility of the RUC reports are obviously highly questionable, considering no other source in the land testifies to anything that resembled a crushing of the attack or a baton charge by the police. And indeed, the film footage from the day, which you can watch on YouTube now, you won't see anything like that. Indeed, the overwhelming evidence testifies that the violence at Burnpullet was directed at PD marchers with no resistance from the RUC, and indeed many activists claim that the RUC joined in on the attack. And indeed, testimonies from the Cameron report itself further indicate that the RUC were not only aware of the location of the attack, but also that the police knew about it, and that unionist politicians knew very well about it. In one revealing interview, Cameron himself states, and this is an interview with the unionist MP at the time, Cameron states that undercover police infiltrated the meeting of Paisley and his supporters in Derry's Guildhall on the 3rd of January, where if anyone familiar with the period knows that the night before the Burnpullet attack, Paisley organised a meeting. The media were locked out, himself and Bunting had a crowd of loyalists in, and it was always the claim that that's where the attack was planned. Of course, Paisley denied it, and here's what Cameron himself had to say in an interview with a unionist MP, and this is long, but I want to quote it at length because I think it's important. He says, "We know that there was at least one special branch officer, if not a number of others in the audience that night, taking note of what was being said, and the position then was that they regarded the situation as being so serious that they carried out a reconnaissance in the vicinity of Burnpullet Bridge. The obvious idea of which was to spot any snipers that there may be in the area on the day in question. Obviously, they were afraid, or must have been afraid, that people would not only concentrate there with something like scatter guns, but there would be something there which would be much more lethal. At this time, there was information available to the RUC of possibly very serious consequences." Just think about that for a second. That's the British judge tasked with investigating events, admitting to a unionist politician that the police were there and they knew about the attack, and then he goes on to conclude the exact opposite in his report. And indeed, other testimonies show that unionist politicians who joined loyalist forces along the route knew of the attack, but also of the names of the attackers. Both Robin Chichester Clark, MP in Derry at the time and brother of the future Prime Minister in the North, and William Anderson, former Mayor and then MP for the City of Derry, were open about their opposition to the march, and they joined loyalists at a number of locations across the route. And the testimony given by both men to the Commission reveals really much about their knowledge of the attack. Anderson, for example, admitted, and I quote, "I had heard that there was likely going to be trouble for the march, and I and Chichester Clark went to Burnpullet Bridge, where we heard there was going to be some trouble." More revealing were Chichester Clark's comments, who knew of, quote, "more extreme Protestant groups in the community who have begun counter-activity, adding, I have no intention of naming them." So really, one doesn't need to engage in too much speculation in those sources to know to draw two conclusions really. First, high-ranking unionist politicians were aware of the attack and its location, but also that they were privy to the identities of those who carried out the attack, and taken alongside the evidence already presented that suggests the police knew of the attack, it seems feasible to conclude that the ambush happened with the knowledge of key elements of the state, both the security forces and the unionist government. Now, this type of evidence, I don't know how long it's been sitting in the Public Records Office, but it's rarely been, to me those are all new sources, I've read all the books about the period, and it's rarely considered among historians who focus on the provocative actions of the PD and that big bad Michael Farrell who called the march in January at Queen's University and went out to disrupt the whole state. So that's the kind of perspective, and indeed the actions of PD marchers who on the 4 day stands in stark contrast to both the state forces and loyalists. The Long March to Derry was really a conscious attempt to challenge sectarian division through the power of Catholic and Protestant self-activity. And the new left were among the most anti-sectarian forces of the period, so they shouldn't be held culpable of bringing about violence and sectarianism in the way that much of mainstream historiography does. And I suppose, moving on to the later period, I think Bert Pullet was of course indicative of the wider experience in 1969, a non-violent movement violently attacked and subsequent repression unleashed against significant sections of the Catholic community. But the fundamental point for me is that the violence and repression didn't come from the fringes just of the loyalist right, but fundamentally from the state apparatus. And the PD was active throughout this period. In the February election, which was a significant election in the sense that the Catholic and the nationalist community further kind of expressed its civil rights demands at the ballot box. There were civil rights MPs who were involved in the civil rights movement, like John Hume, were elected in this election. PD stood in 8 constituencies. It took over 23,000 votes. One PD member, a student, Fergus Woods, was about 200 votes off getting elected. So even the PD, which was a student group with no resources, was getting quite a significant vote. The electoral high point came, of course, when Bernadette Davin was elected as MP for Mid Ulster with over 33,000 votes. And I think Davin's election really summed up the contradiction that faced the PD and that faced the left at this time. And that small groups of socialists had garnered significant support. They mobilised huge swathes of the population, but they had no real political strategy or organisation or coherency to offer a way forward amidst the crisis of 1969. Thus, after sectarian repression reached a crescendo in the summer of 69, the left very much found themselves on the margins. Now, the major turning point, of course, came with the Loyalist marching season in August. In Derry, after small-scale riots broke out between youth and the RUC, an uprising broke out. The Battle of the Bogside revolt spread across the north after NICRA put out a call for civil rights demonstrators across the north to demonstrate and take police pressure off Derry. Violence was widespread in Belfast. Unprecedented repression after crowds marched on police stations during the 13th and the 14th of August. And again, members of the police specials were at the forefront of attacking Catholic residents alongside loyalists during scenes that included the deployment of armoured vehicles, that included the murder of a number of innocent people, including a Che, Patrick Rooney. And by 15th of August, hundreds and hundreds of Catholic homes have been burnt to the ground. I think something like 5% of the Catholic population of Belfast have been forced to move out of their homes. I'm not going to say much more about 69, only to say that people should look out for Michael McCann's forthcoming book, who's sitting at the front row there, which is due out next year on the anniversary, and no doubt will be a meticulous study of those events. So I think now it's time for another song, which kind of captures that.
This is one of my favourite songs, and it's, in my own opinion, it's one of the most powerful songs to emerge from our struggle. It's written by Jack Warshaw from the People of School Property. And I'm not going to sing it all, I'm going to sing most of it because there's a verse that I'm not really sure because I haven't sung it for a long time, so I'll get most of it. You'll get the drift. And it's a song that I could dedicate to anybody who's been brutalised by the Peelers or the Brits. If you've had your door booted in or you're about to have your door booted in, you never know. That's the way it goes here, isn't it? So we saw it called No Time for Love. Because you know as soon as that door comes in, they come in through, there's no love.
And they tell us who suffer the tear gas and the torture that we're in the wrong. Doesn't have the love of the home and the morning of time, for tears are from fear in the morning. No time for goodbye, no time to ask why.
and the sound of the sighing of the men's pain of the morn. Suffering the torture they read in it says, went crazy with the letters and day. The limits of pain they endured, but the loneliness got them instead. And justice as justice was served by well men of cups. Sometimes they fought for a will to survive, for time they just wish they were dead. Those who never loved, they come in the morning of time, for tears of the fears and the mourn. No time to goodbye, no time to last, so why? And the sound of the sky in our heads. Vanzetti, Steve Biko, Frank Ryan, and Joe Hill. They came from Patsy O'Hara, Bobby Sands, most of his friends. Busted from Chicago, Saigon, Sadiga, Elbel, and Belfast. And the places that don't reach the headlines and listen to the friends. But tears of fears and mourning. No time to goodbye, no time to ask why. When the sound of the silence, I love mourning. Come all you people to give your brothers and sisters the will to fight on. They say we can get used to war, that doesn't mean the war's been gone. Need to see to survive, just like people in June. That's what's gonna only get to them. First thing get through to you. Don't stop in love, they come in the morning no time. But tears all the fears and the mourning. No time to goodbye, no time to ask why. And the sound of the silence.
In 1969, autonomous zones where the RUC couldn't enter were of course established. Free Derry was the head of resistance, of course, where MP Bernadette Devlin, alongside others, led the defence of the area, where state forces were effectively driven out of the bogside until October 1969. Free Belfast too lasted some weeks, as a large parts of Catholic West Belfast became no-go areas where British troops and RUC forces couldn't enter. The People's Democracy and socialists more generally played a crucial role in these uprisings through the Citizens Defence Committees, which sprang up really to organise much of the resistance in Belfast and Derry. Yet much like its involvement in the wider civil rights movement, the PD and the left was largely submerged into these and lacked any organised force. In Belfast, for example, the student activists of the PD played a crucial role in terms of producing newspapers, running Radio Free Belfast, and putting out political propaganda against both the British troops and the Unionist government. And I think Eamon the Derry Socialist, Eamon McCann, who wasn't a PD member, the PD didn't have a group in Derry at the time, but working very closely with them, later took stock of the period and noted the kind of powerful obstacles that faced the civil rights movement in 1968 and 69. And McCann noted the realistic possibility we did have and didn't take was of recruiting relatively rapidly from the masses of angry, urgent working class youth whom we had helped bring onto the streets and perhaps enter in 1969 with the revolutionary socialist organisation of a few hundred strong. I want to explore that type of idea. I think part of the problem for the left and for groups like the PD was really the political incoherence of the left as it entered the civil rights struggle during the kind of heady days of 1968. Almost the entire left had been really united with the view that partition was irrelevant in the struggle for civil rights. The election in February that it talked about, the PD explicitly stated this in its manifesto. It says the border is irrelevant to our struggle. Others viewed the question of partition as one that ought to be parked until a later date after democratic reforms have been realised. But the obvious problem by 1969 clearly was that reforms and any move to reform had been consistently blocked by the Orange Machine, which relied heavily on sectarianism for its survival, which relied heavily on the structures of discrimination for its survival, and which purported a wholly exaggerated view of the type of threat that the civil rights demands proposed. So overcoming sectarianism then inevitably meant overcoming the power of the state. I think elements of the left did understand this. Michael Farrell, who was central to pushing the PD in the socialist direction later in 1969, laid out his view in I think April or May of 69. He said the border must go, but it must go in the direction of a socialist republic, and not just into a republic which might at some future date become socialist. Only the concept of a socialist republic can ever reconcile Protestant workers to the end of the border. Now, as we've seen, the PD were far too small, they were too flimsily organised to put a perspective like this into practice. And I think, I suppose, for socialists and for people on the left generally, the main current capable of transforming the situation in the North tends to be the trade union movement. So I wanted to make some comment on that in terms of the research that I've carried out. I mean, the trade union movement had been involved in pushing class politics to the fore of civil rights agitation, but it had done so in a largely formal and kind of tokenistic way during the early days of NICRA, when kind of letter writing and lobbying was the order of the day as opposed to the active street mobilisation. And I think more generally, the history of the trade union movement during the beginning of the civil rights movement and the outbreak of the Troubles is a failure, the history of a failure really in challenging the sectarian practices of the Northern state. Recognising this, of course, doesn't in any way dismiss or diminish the positive record of many trade unionists in the North. Many activists made a valiant effort to stop the slide into sectarian violence, but too many key figures in the trade union movement stayed quiet, I think, in the face of the growing loyalist reaction that I've talked about. Some were worse, of course, actively supporting pogroms against Catholics. Far too often, bigots were allowed to hold office without being challenged, and far too long, state repression went unacknowledged. And indeed, the absence, I suppose, of the official trade union movement, even in the early stages of the civil rights agitation in groups like NICRA, is quite glaring. Now, the most important moment, I suppose, of trade union activism in the early Troubles came in August 1969, when in the wake of Bombay Street being burnt to the ground, shop stewards in East Belfast agitated against the threat of serious attacks on Catholic workers in the shipyards. And this really possibly, quite realistically, possibly prevented the type of pogroms that happened in the 1920s. But I think the problem is that these efforts, well, good as they were never really generalised across the trade union movement as a whole. And actually, the response of the Irish Congress of Trade Union in August 1969 was to argue for a restoration of law and order. And of course, this was happening when barricades went up to defend against state repression, and it ignored the fact that the very forces of law and order, the RUC and the Beef Specials, were the central force of violence at this time. And this would really be the picture, I think, as things continued into the 1970s, particularly as British troops showed their ability to repress the Catholic community more effectively than the RUC and the Beef Specials ever had. Support for the forces of law and order and support for the state took on an even more reactionary hue. And for me, the whole kind of sorry saga of the trade union movement in this period is summed up by the fate of the often lauded NILP activist Sandy Scott, who led opposition in 1969, only to end up taking part in trade union delegations to the unionist government that called for tougher security measures in the run-up to the internment. And these took place, you know, alongside future leaders of the UDA. And in one such delegation in June 1970, the trade unionists told the government, quote, that it was possible that some Roman Catholic workers might be gently requested to leave for their own good. And I just want to read this out. This is another extended version of the report. And it says, the trade unionists told the unionist government, it was also possible that there might well be cases of intimidation, and it was hoped that they would be permitted to deal with it. It was also hoped that the management would be understanding in its attitude to small groups of men who might gather in the yard. The Unionist Minister for Commerce at the time, Robin Bailey, ended this particular meeting by giving a commitment that he would speak to management in the shipyard to ensure that this latter point would happen. So really what I'm trying to say is that the inability of the trade union movement to challenge loyalist ideas inside the working class movement directly facilitated the rise of the loyalist backlash against reform, which, for example, significantly mobilised large layers of Protestant workers demanding the introduction of internment in 1961, and indeed later culminated in the Ulster Workers' Council strike in the mid-1970s, which was really a reactionary attempt to restore Orange rule in the North. Now, as I said earlier, none of this denigrates the remarkable role that the individual trade unionists played, or the best elements of class solidarity in the labour movement. There's a rich tradition of unity too, but there was also a rotten history of acquiescence in the face of sectarianism. It wasn't always as extreme as that of those documents that I've just quoted, but it usually had the same features: a refusal to condemn state repression, an unwillingness to challenge sectarianism within the labour movement, and the advocacy of support for the institutions of a repressive state above all else. And indeed, if you look at oppositional forces at the time, if you look, for example, at the NILP, it's the same process, only on an even much more acute level. The NILP, for example, ended up in Faulkner's government in 1971, despite taking a sort of a role in the early civil rights agitation, was complicit in the introduction of internment. And by the time that civil rights marchers were being gunned down in the streets in Bloody Sunday, NILP elected reps, Vivian Simpson was the MP, couldn't bring himself to condemn it on the floor of the Northern Parliament. And this really showed how disconnected the labour movement were from the growing movement to smash internment and to smash Stormont. And the reason that I'm drawing on this, because I think that ultimately the real turning point, I mean, everybody knows that the real turning point in the early part was internment. And of course, for me, what I would suggest is that it wasn't just the turning point for the kind of later history, but it was also the turning point for oppositional forces in the Northern State. It was a turning point for the civil rights movement. And of course, when we talk about internment, we're not just talking about the jailing of people without trial. We're not just talking about the torture. We're talking about mass repression. We're talking about mass incarceration in working class areas. We're talking about massacre at Ballymurphy, Spring Hill, the Bogside. And what August 69 was for Belfast and Derry, I think internment was for the entire nationalist community. And internment was met with a mass explosion, a mass movement erupted. Tens of thousands of people took part in a rent and rate strike. Even British government documentation, some of the ones that I've seen, alludes to up to 90% of people in West Belfast weren't paying rent and rates at this time, and the British government was doing all it could at this time to downplay the rent and rates strike. And I think that, you know, on Casement Park, a couple of days after internment, 15,000 people gathered in the, what do you call the stadium in Derry, the Brandywell. 8,000 people took part in a mass sit-down. Civil resistance committees sprang up all across the north, and alongside internment came a ban on marches. Now, the PD, I think, significantly emerged as one of the groups willing to remobilise the civil rights movement in this period and challenge Faulkner's ban on marches. It's worth saying that the PD weren't alone in this. There was the Northern Resistance Movement was set up at the end of 1971. I think the PD worked alongside Republicans such as Mario Drum and really pushed ahead for a remobilisation of the civil rights movement in 1971. The remobilisation came on Christmas Day in 1971. There was a march organised from Beechmount down the falls, and it was intended to go to the Longcash internment camp. It didn't make it there. The British Army harassed it as much as they could. It ended up being a mass sit-down on the motorway. But nevertheless, the remobilisation that was pushed ahead from both the PD and elements of the Republican movement really forced the wider civil rights movement to come back out on the streets and those who have retreated off the back of 1969. And this remobilisation exploded at the beginning of January in 1972. People may be familiar with the marches at McGilligan, people like John Hume led, there were marches in West Belfast. This culminated, of course, in Bloody Sunday, in the 30th of January 1972. I think Paul's got a couple of songs that can kind of encapsulate this period.
It's funny enough you should mention that today. Well, on Monday the 9th of August, at 4:30 a.m. in the morning, Irish men from all of the six counties were taken from their homes and imprisoned in the Longcase concentration camp. The song was born of the civil resistance campaign which followed internment and is dedicated to the memory of the men behind the wire.
Armored cars and tanks and guns came the day by our sons. Every man will stand behind the man behind the wire. Through the little streets of Belfast in the dark of early morn, British soldiers came running, wrecking all of the little storm. Heedless of crying children, dragging fathers from their beds, bidding sons while helpless mothers watch the blood pour from their heads. Armored cars and tanks and guns came to dig away our sons, but everyone will stand behind the men behind the wire. Not for them the judge and jury, or indeed a crime at all. Being Irish means we're guilty, so we're guilty one and all. Round the world, strip for echo, from that men are here again. England's name again is sullied in the eyes of past men. Armored cars and tanks and guns in the day away our sons, but everyone will stand behind the men behind the wire. We march behind our banners, when we stand behind our men. We will help them free to help us build a nation once again. All the people stand together, proudly be on your way. Never fear or never falter, till the boys come home to stay. Armored cars and tanks and guns, in the day of our sons. But every man will stand behind the man behind the wire. Armored cars and tanks and guns came the day of our sons, but everyone will stand behind
the man behind the wire. Now, British military intervention, of course, crystallised the question of partition in the North. Clearly, it was an intervention dictated by well-worn and often brutal colonial strategies, internment without trial, shoot to kill, the use of counterinsurgency operations such as loyalist paramilitaries as allies, to name a few. And the level of state violence in this period was of course the major contributing factor to filling the ranks of those forces who had an immediate answer to the question of overcoming the state through struggle, through armed struggle. And the state's reaction to reform really created far bigger grievances than those that originally highlighted by the civil rights movement. I mean, the idea, I suppose, when you talk to civil rights marchers, you know, about what they went out on and, you know, marched in the early days, and then the idea of what would come after it, it's quite a glaring thing. So the state's reaction to reform created far greater and far more sustained grievances. And I think it is worth remembering that if you look at the period between 1968 and 1972, the real significant advances that were made came really through popular struggle from below. They certainly didn't come from parliamentary manoeuvres, and I think it's questionable whether they came primarily through armed struggle either. The development of the Northern Ireland Housing Executive, established after the Housing Executive Act in 1971, was a clear concession won by the civil rights movement, as was, you know, all the changes to the voting legislation and all that. But the overriding lesson, of course, of the civil rights struggle was that the primary force of violence and division was the existence of the state itself, and if the state was to continue, then the violence and the division itself would continue. And I think 50 years on from the civil rights movement and the history of 1968, it's a history that points to an upsurge which really contradicts the conventional view of oppositional politics in the history of the North. That view is often one that's just prevented as a straightforward choice between parliamentarism, parliamentary nationalism and armed struggle. Actually, the political convulsions of the late 1960s give a brief glimpse of a time when people power emerged in a way that I think heralded the possibility of a different form of politics. Groups like the PD would later theorise this stuff in terms of mass struggle and mass action, and there's some interesting stuff to read on that. For me, the challenge of 1968 really was in essence the challenge to reforge the politics of James Connolly in Ireland. And I would categorise that broadly by anti-imperialism, anti-partitionism, a rejection of the pan-class nature of both unionist and nationalist projects, and the advocacy of 32 county socialism based upon revolutionary class politics and Protestant and Catholic workers' unity here in the North. And I think today, faced with a sectarian state that continues to deny rights, the task to reforge the politics of James Connolly very much remains. So I'm going to finish on Connolly. You must be able to help sing a song about James Connolly. Thanks very much.
A song called Connolly was there.
Well, there is a page in history where the workers they fought back. When the might of exploitation at last began to crack. In farm and field and factory and workshop, mine and mill. Flame was lit, became brave and still. For Connolly was there, Connolly was there. Brave wall from Don to James Connolly was there. William Martin Murphy and his Dublin billionaires tried bribery, corruption, hypocrisy and prayers to stem the transport union that Scots they didn't enlist. But all their work was shattered by a scar and iron fist. For Connolly was there, Connolly was there, brave bold and Donald James Connolly was there. Bosses tried to squash the lads when down on Glasgow's glade. A voice of roar and thunder, she of them in their stride. In Liverpool and Belfast where the workers' life was held. Connolly rose and gave them all the trust to you I tell. For Connolly was there, Connolly was there, brave Bob and Donald, James Connolly was there. Irishmen, the day will come when the workers one and all were raised up from the bended knee and ready to the call. Throw out the boss's tyranny and cheer from shore to shore for a socialist republic and for freedom evermore. And Connolly will be there, Connolly will be there, brave old Donald James, Connolly will be there, Connolly will be there, Connolly will be there, brave old Donald James, Connolly will be there.
Everybody, I'm Jordan Mona. Does somebody want to come up and get these flowers? It's the least we could do. Thank you so much.
Yeah, me and Focus Tommy are the same.